Buenas tardes. Good afternoon. Proud to be here on behalf of Tecnológico de Monterrey, together with Jose Juan Pablo Murra, who participated in a previous panel. I dare say Andres Martinez is always part of Monterrey Tech because he speaks so highly of what we do together. So thank you, Andres, for that. The title of this session, and I'm sure Andres Rosenthal and others here will agree, Arturo Sarucan and others who were good friends of Bob Pastor, it's a fitting tribute to Bob. We decided that the name, the title of this panel would be The North American Idea in 2022. Bob, as you know, passed away, regrettably, 8 years ago, early in his life. He was the most eloquent and, I dare say, persistent advocate for a regional vision. And he even spoke in his 2011 book, The North American Idea, of a North American genetic code. Shannon's book, by the way, is very much the best call to arms on a North American partnership since Bob was rallying the troops many years ago, so thank you for that. Let me say at the onset that some of us in the room were part of the initial years of the U.S.-Mexico Foundation. We are extremely, extremely proud of the work that Enrique, Emilio, and the leadership are doing today, and for their accomplishments, which far exceed our own in our time. Our heartfelt appreciation to Claudia, Isa, Axel, and all the foundation's team on a very successful forum. Paraphrasing Monica Lozano, this is the time for us to re-engage, reimagine, and recreate the North American idea. And this forum is certainly a contribution in that regard. Shannon O'Neil is one of the most respected experts and prolific authors on Latin American and global affairs, a point of reference for anyone interested in the international dimension of Mexico and North America. She is the VP and Deputy Director at the Council on Foreign Relations, one of the key foreign policy organizations in the world. Will Hurd served as a U.S. representative for Texas from 2015 until last year. He was the expert congressman on technology security and cybersecurity, serving as the very young chair of the IT subcommittee and the vice chair of the border subcommittee. During his time, he was the only African-American Republican in the House of Representatives, and the only Republican representative along the whole U.S.-Mexico border. A computer science graduate from Texas A&M, he spent almost a decade at the CIA, leading undercover intelligence operations in India, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. We will be focusing on Shannon's upcoming book, The Globalization Myth, and on Will's recent book, American Reboot. Both are truly, believe me, they're truly essential new reads. Will's has been available since March, if I'm not mistaken, and Shannon's will be out in a couple of weeks. Thank you both, by the way, for sharing 80 copies each of your books. The audience will find cards randomly placed under some of the seats, so we want to look for that, for you to collect a book at the registration desk at the end of lunch.
And there's a prize on page 55 if you have American Reboot under your book, under your seat.
We weren't prepared for that, but thank you, Will. Shannon and Will, let me start with your experience in Mexico. You both lived in Mexico years ago. Can you tell us briefly what that was all about, what that experience was all about, and what it meant, and what kind of an impact it has had in your lives? Shannon?
Great. Well, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you to the U.S.-Mexico Foundation and all of our sponsors for hosting here. You know, I've lived in Mexico in two separate times. So I lived here in the 1990s. I arrived about 2 weeks before Colosio was assassinated and lived here for 3 years through the Mexican peso crisis and all that happened afterward, working in the private sector here and in investment banking. And then I returned in 2002, 2003 as a visiting professor at the ITAM. I was working on a study there, and it was a different time, right? It was a time of democratization in Mexico. It was a time of Vicente Fox's reign. It was a time of changing dynamics. And so in both of them, you know, I saw a rapidly changing Mexico. I saw those first years of NAFTA coming into space and the dynamics of the economy changing, the dynamics of politics changing. And they've continued to do so in the years that I've come back just as a visitor rather than a resident.
Thank you, Shannon. Will?
Well, I also want to join in saying thanks to the U.S.-Mexico Foundation for having me. And I need to issue a disclaimer up front. If you don't like anything that I say, two-thirds of what I've learned about Mexico I've learned from Stony Burke, one of your board members, so you can direct your complaints to Stony directly. But Mexico City specifically changed my life. It changed the trajectory of my life. I was 18 years old and had never been outside of Texas. I was going to school at Texas A&M University, and I was a computer science major. And I saw a sign on one of the walls in a building I was studying in that said, take two journalism classes in Mexico City for $425. I had $450 in my bank account, so I came to Mexico and fell in love being in another culture, reading things I only read about in books. I added international studies, met this former CIA tough guy that told the most amazing stories, and that began my career and trajectory into the CIA. And so all that started from my time here at La Salle. And, Enrique, you can tell the next time the Ambassador Salazar, tasks you with something, you can tell him I attached you to have him increase those F-1 visas, right? You know, he was asking everyone here to do things. The U.S. government has a role as well in getting more students, not only in the U.S., but here.
Great, thank you both. Un favor, sobre todo en las mesas de atrás. Lamentablemente hay mucho eco en el salón y al menos acá al frente estamos escuchando mucho ruido. Entonces vamos a tener suficiente tiempo. Claudia organizó muy bien que tuviéramos suficiente tiempo para convivencia entre las sesiones, pero de nuevo, en honor de nuestros dos invitados que vienen de tan lejos, les pedimos un poquito de silencio. Mil gracias. Let me take 1 minute, if I may, to set the stage for the conversation based on, obviously, on the two books. That's the reason why we're here. And these very turbulent times, that's an understatement. There are six geostrategic trends that give rise to much concern and many contrasting assessments. Number one, the perceived strength or weakening, depending on who you're talking to, of China. Two, the alleged decline of the U.S. Three, the post-pandemic realignment of value chains, which is a key issue in this forum. The evolution of technology in the digital space, the dominance of big tech, eroding the strength and role of the governments and institutions, and the gradual decline of the demographic bonus in Mexico, thus the need for a sense of urgency in everything that Mexico does. So these six trends are obviously linked, they're interconnected, and have a tremendous bearing on the future of Mexico and our region. So let's start first with two quick individual rounds of questions around these trends, and then we'll do, if I may, a discussion together. Okay? Shannon, you point out that despite all the hoopla, globalization is, end of the day, a regional affair. And trade has only deeply transformed, quite frankly, the economies and societies of maybe two dozen countries around the world. Can you describe briefly what you mean? Because this is a fundamental topic in your book. And are you suggesting that globalization, even in this relatively modest version, hasn't been worth it or not?
So when we look at the last 40 years, you know, we talk a lot about globalization and people, you know, you love it or you hate it or you have strong feelings about it. But actually, when you start looking at what has happened, yes, we have seen a huge increase in trade and finance and people and others crossing borders. So we've seen trade go from $2 trillion to $22 trillion a year that flows across borders. But it doesn't go as far as we all imagine. In fact, the average product that goes internationally goes about 3,000 miles. And that's not much further than a flight from New York to California.
It's certainly not enough to cross oceans. So when we think about this globalization of trade, we need to look a little bit more closely on where it actually goes. And what I argue in the book and the data that I look at shows that actually it has been much more regional than it has been global. Now, we can all point to world-class companies that indeed are global. So you can say, well, Boeing sources from 58 different countries all over the world. But alongside each Boeing, there are tens of thousands of companies that, yes, did go abroad, but when they did, they really went just next door. Now, within this regionalization that happened alongside or even more than globalization, not all places around the world were created equal. And I think this actually helps explain a bit some of the globalization winners and losers, at least on a country level. So some areas in the world didn't regionalize at all. You look at the rest of Latin America, you look at Africa or the Middle East or South Asia, and when they send goods abroad, when they trade, they almost always go far away, not close to their neighbors. And I think that has been, frankly, to their detriment in their ability to tap into supply chains and grow up the value-added chain and provide better jobs and grow their economies. But we have seen three big regions arise. We've seen North America, what we're talking about here today. We've seen Europe, and we have seen Asia. And the argument I make in the book is, yes, all three of these regions have regionalized as they have gone abroad and internationalized, but not equally. And in fact, Europe and Asia have integrated, regionalized much more than North America. And that's been to their economic strength and, frankly, to North America's detriment. And I just let me put a few numbers on the table so we can see the difference here. When you look at North American trade, 40% of trade stays within the region. So 40 cents of every dollar, 40 centavos of every peso stay in North America. That's pretty good compared to Latin America, other parts of the world where it's 10 cents, 15 cents. But if you look at Asia, it's 60 cents of every dollar. 60% of trade and money and flow of people and ideas stays within Asia. And in Europe, it's nearing two-thirds, 66, almost 70%, depending on what you're measuring. So they're much more integrated, and that, to me, is one of the reasons why we face such steep competition from Asia, or we usually say China, but really Asia, and then we face from Europe as well. So the reality that's gotten us here over 40 years of the creation of global supply chains and this wave of globalization is really one more of regionalization.
If you want to get the rest of the details, read her book. I'm serious here. It's a fantastic book. It's not just a primer on international trade. As I mentioned before, it picks up on where Bob Pastor left in terms of what North America is and should be all about. I congratulate you on the book. It's really fantastic. De nuevo, por favor, un poquito de silencio en las mesas de atrás. Tenemos menos de 50 minutos por delante y de nuevo, después habrá tiempo para convivencia. As Henry VIII used to tell his wives, I promise I won't keep you long. Shannon, your colleague Richard Haass says we're living, and I quote, in a dangerous decade. Wonderful article recently published in the current issue of Foreign Affairs, in fact. Given recent events, it sounds like an understatement. In that context, are you concerned with a new era of entrenchment and protectionism?
I am. One big shift, I would say, that we've seen, it's been happening for a decade, but has accelerated with COVID and with some of the changes that Richard talks about, is we have seen the return and rise of industrial policy. So if you look at the beginning of the 21st century, you know, at least rhetorically, if not in action, almost all countries in the world were talking about opening markets, pushing for more connections around the world. The WTO was sort of at its height of operation, was letting China in and bringing the world together. And now the WTO is on the rocks, let's say. But overall, you see country after country deciding that they need to intervene in their economy more than in the past. And this isn't, I would say, your grandmother or grandfather's industrial policy, not 20th century industrial policy, which was often about economic competitiveness. There's still that element, but there are many more issues that countries care about. They care about climate change. They want to change their economic structures and energy systems so that they can combat climate change. They care about domestic equity reasons. Inequality is a big reason why you see industrial policy stepping in. There are reasons of overall, quote-unquote, national security, which is a much broader basket than it used to be. It's not just defense, but it has all sorts of things about technologies and surveillance and access to computers and all kinds of other sectors. So all of these are defining the reasons that governments feel the need to, and perhaps the hubris, to step in and intervene. Some of these are important, right? We want to change the direction of climate change. We want to make sure people are safer and more secure and resilient in that side. But some of it, Raul, as you say, is probably a good dose of good old protectionism and will be a challenge. And I think overlapping this with the regionalization that is happening, I think the real question is, will we see protectionism by one country that just walls themselves off? Or will you start seeing even a deepening of these blocks where certain regions decide to throw it in together with their own goals, with their own kind of industrial policies that bring them together and provide a platform that actually provides some benefits even as it does wall off those in other places?
Thank you. At the September 6, 2001 joint session of Congress with President Fox as the speaker, we heard one buzzword, and the buzzword was trust. And maybe two underlying aspirations for the relationship from there on, a shared responsibility and common destiny. 5 days later, there was a new paradigm in the world, and that was security. 6 days later, China's WTO membership was approved. Overnight, this is 22 years ago, we were a new era. Fast forward to today. As a region, North America, where do we lead and where do we lag behind?
So, you know, it's interesting just focusing in on that year 2000, 22 years ago. When you look at the effects of NAFTA, and especially on this regionalization, if you look from the early 90s to 2000, trade within North America rose from about 40 cents on the dollar to almost 50 cents. So you saw a huge increase in integration, and trade between the countries increased much faster than trade with the rest of the world. So NAFTA did what it was supposed to do. It integrated. After you hit 2000, China's entrance into the WTO, those numbers go back, they erode, and you go back to 40% of trade as intra-regional trade in North America. So North America basically lost its mojo. It lost this integrating capacity, and you know, NAFTA and now USMCA didn't prove enough to face these other integrating blocks, frankly. So there was a bit of a loss of a leadership there. Now, I would say today we are in a new space. And so the globalization of the last 40 years is changing. We're hitting a new phase of globalization. And it's not just COVID. It's not just, the Russia-Ukraine or some of these other geopolitical tensions. It's a whole host of issues. It is the automation and technology people have been talking about here. It's, you know, robotics and AI and other things that are coming into manufacturing and other production platforms. It is climate change and how that is changing the logistics around the world. And those areas of the world that depend particularly on port infrastructure, like Asia, have much more investment that they have to put in to sort of recuperate some of the challenges they have for their logistics. It is demographics. And you know, Raul, while you said, you know, Mexican demographics aren't once what they were, well, Chinese demographics are really not once what they were. And actually, China has more people leaving the labor force every year than coming into it, and that will continue, as many other countries in Asia do as well. So there are a lot of things that are changing around the world, and there's the geopolitics, right? There are the US-China tensions, there are obviously the Russia-Ukraine tensions and the like. So all of this is changing the way supply chains, the way manufacturing has been working for 30 years. They're offering an opportunity, a fluidity that we really haven't seen for a generation. And so there, I think there is an opportunity for North America to lead. But it's not a done deal, right? There are other regions around the world that are trying to lead too. And let me just leave with this is, while we're trying to figure it out in our politics, China especially is trying to lead, right? They have put tens of billions, hundreds of billions of dollars into the Belt and Road Initiative. And you hear about that here in Latin America, that they're investing in dams or 5G networks and the like. But the vast majority of that money is going to Asia. They're trying to connect Asia to each other. They are also doubling down on free trade agreements in Asia, which is something that they didn't really do for decades. You know, the RCEP, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, they've gotten that passed and over the hump, and that's now in effect. They want to join CPTPP, which is something that the U.S., you know, bowed out of. Mexico obviously is part of it. Do you see them trying to bring their region together? If there's going to be a change in supply chains, they want to be at the center of it, just the way we do in North America. So we have a lot to compete with here. It's not a done deal that we would lead in this next round.
Two quick questions, and then we'll go to Will. One, you know, the foundation is doing tremendous work and is poised to do a lot more in terms of narrative regarding North America and integration. And people like Arturo Sarucán and many others here do a fantastic job on a daily basis in terms of that. But still, if we take it all together, there's a rather tepid, lukewarm approach to the narrative of North America. Why is that? Why are we so complacent? And the second question, if I may, is what about trilateral? Do you see any room for that? Or are we, for all practical purposes, stuck with a sort of a hub and spoke kind of approach or a double bilateral type of arrangement here?
You know, I think the tepid response, unfortunately, and this easily dovetails into what Will's going to talk about, is that yes, while this is guided by the private sector, yes, while it's companies that need to make decisions, that policies matter. And especially as we see the rise of industrial policies and governments all around the world intervening more and more in their economies, for good and bad, policies are going to matter even more. Right? And so if you want to get beyond the tepid movement of a little bit here and one factory here and one, you know, expansion of something here or there, it really has to come from the government level. And I will, you know, speak for my own government, and Will will have thoughts on this too. I don't think the United States is focused on this the way we should be. We're sometimes distracted by the urgent, which is war in, you know, Europe and other challenges. But this is the important, and this is where the medium to long term comes. And that's often where we don't always do the best in our political system, is really getting at the medium to long term. So I think that the US often in its policymaking is reactive. It needs to be pushed into these things, whether it's other countries bringing things to the agenda or those within the US bringing it to the agenda, the private sector and others. So that's part of the tepid reaction. And then I would say too that, you know, we have seen a change in the interest, frankly, in the Mexican government in this deeper integration. We don't see it as a priority to see those deeper ties, to do the kinds of things on the infrastructure side, the energy side, the logistics side, the education side, that would actually allow this integration that we're talking about here to happen. So I think both of those sides. And, you know, Canada, I do think, is trying to fight the good fight, and you have governments there trying to get people interested, but we need to make sure that all three governments get involved, and I don't see that there yet.
All right. Thank you, Shannon. Will, there's no free lunch. Actually, there's no lunch today. All that noise is lunch, so sorry about that. You won three congressional elections in a district in Texas, which is, if I'm not mistaken, the size of Georgia, larger than 26 or 27 states, reaching all the way from the outskirts of El Paso to Laredo and San Antonio. So really huge, 820 miles of the U.S.-Mexico border. 70%+ of the population is Hispanic, only 3% is African American. The district had voted Democrat in recent elections. I can go on and on. And in fact, as a Republican congressman, you were an outspoken opponent of some of the most prominent Trump initiatives. You famously mentioned the border wall was, and I quote, a third century solution to a 21st century problem, which was great. In other words, it seems you were elected and you remained a Republican against all odds. How do you explain your success?
Well, nobody thought a black Republican could win in a 72% Latino district. Actually, that's not true. Jerry knew. Where's Jerry? Jerry thought I could win, so I appreciate you, Jerry.
Did he put any money in?
Yeah, look, they were very supportive. And the reality is you talk about local issues. You talk about things that people care about. I would tell people that, you know, yo soy un Latino en mi corazón, right? Because of my experiences, not only here in Mexico City, but on in La Frontera as well. And so you show up. Talk about the issues that, you know, everybody cares. I don't care who you are, where you're from. You care about putting food on your table, a roof over your head, and making sure the people that you love are healthy, happy, and safe. And that's the same whether you're in a deep red
neighborhood in San Antonio, Texas, or in a rural community, a blue rural community in El Paso. And so that's what I tried to focus on. And in this district specifically, the border matters, trade with Mexico matters. I've oftentimes explained that the border is like a third country. Right? We have more in common with northern Mexico and southern United States than the border has with New York and the East Coast or the Yucatan here in Mexico. And so understanding the importance of these communities, the border is not a line, right? It's one place where two communities come together. And so the fact that I focus on that was one of the things that propelled my success.
I can attest to that. I'm part of his old constituency. Yeah. I live in San Antonio in his district, and I ran into him frequently at the gas station. Yeah. And bitters. And I got a 5-minute report on what he was doing every time we met. So, you know, it's amazing how you followed up and how you kept in touch, no matter where the context of that meeting was.
And I think he might have voted for me 2 out of 3 times.
Right? Of course. And I put some money into it, Jerry. Bipartisan, quote unquote, is a term that evokes nostalgia. It takes us back to Reagan and Tip O'Neill working together on the Fiscal Responsibility Act of 1982, even to Clinton Gingrich working on a balanced budget. Tell us about your road trip with Beto O'Rourke, the current Democratic candidate for governor in Texas. Something that would have really been quite unremarkable 20 years ago, made national headlines, continues to make the headlines. I dare say very much along the lines of a Thelma and Louise moment with a happy ending. Yep, amazing.
In essence, what happened, Beto was representing part of El Paso, I represented part of El Paso. We had worked together on border issues, on veteran affairs issues, and he happened to be in San Antonio helping me with some veterans related things, and it was one of the snowpocalypses of Washington, D.C., and all of our flights got canceled. I'm a loyal Southwest Airlines flyer, and so if Southwest Airlines cancels a flight, you know it's bad, you know, because they fly in anything. I don't know if Southwest is here, but thank you for getting me all the places over the last 8 years. And Beto said, let's drive back and live stream it. And I called my staff, and I was like, hey, what do y'all think about this? And I thought they were using reverse psychology. They're like, sure, do it. And I was like, wait a minute, you're trying to get me to say no. But we drove back a 35-hour trip, 31 hours in the car, 29 hours live streamed. And we had 25 million people watch us on social media, and we were literally on every news program in the United States. And we debated, this is about the time of repealing the Affordable Care Act. You know, we had a 6-hour debate on health care. And you know, what was fascinating was the first 30 minutes was pretty terrible. Beto was driving, I was reading his socials, and people were super nasty to me. They were talking about leaving me on the side of the road and doing all these things. And we only turned the feed off twice. And one time was I turned it off to be like, Beto, if this continues, I'm not going to be able to do this. But what happened was it changed, and people were like, this is great. You know, you're inspiring us to have a competition of ideas rather than personalities. And my two takeaways, one that I saw already in a district like the one I represented, way more unites us than divides us as a country. Even though we feel like it's the opposite, it's not true. And the second one is the body politic is interested in us being able to disagree without being disagreeable. A bipartisanship doesn't actually mean agreeing on everything. It means cooperating to get something done that improves society and uplifts humanity. And that road trip, even though it's 5 years later and people still talk about it, it's something that people hope for and wish existed. It doesn't, and we can get into details about our primary system and how that drives partisanship, but more people would like to see us get big things done.
and we're in a political and cultural moment where it's getting harder to do those big things.
So give us the two-minute formula. I mean, how do we go back to disagreeing without destroying ourselves?
Well, it starts with, in America, people need to vote in primaries, plain and simple. In the last election, 2020, 67% of voting eligible Americans voted in the general election. That was a high watermark in the history of our elections, but only 23% of Americans that could vote voted in primaries. And if you look at the House, this is a hard number. 92% of House seats are decided in a primary. Most of those seats are, and sorry for the math lesson here, most of those seats are decided by between 54,000 and 60,000 votes. So that means 30,000 people are deciding who gets to go to Washington, D.C. And those 30,000 people are some of the craziest people you're ever going to meet.
But they vote.
And so what we need to do is have those people that vote in general elections vote in primaries. And voting in a general election is the floor of civic duty. We need people to vote because if you don't like your options in November, it's because you chose not to participate in March, April, May, and June. And if we're able to do that, then you're gonna see people that are more focused on solving problems than throwing bombs.
Let me elaborate on that. History doesn't repeat itself, but sometimes it does rhyme. Matthew Continetti suggests in his new book that we may be going back in the U.S. to a kind of John Birch, Joe McCarthy era.
Yeah.
The fault lines between red and blue and urban and rural and working class and elites and gray and brown are deepening, compounded in fact by COVID. So you highlight in your book the need for the Republican Party to realign its action. And you do it in a very compelling way. I loved your book. I really did. What do you have in mind, and is it feasible when the party itself seems hostage to President Trump and to MAGA, and the U.S. society is going through the apparent, at least, trauma of a profound demographic, economic, and cultural transformation? How do you do it?
Yes, we can evolve, because guess what? It's actually been worse. In the 60s in Washington, D.C., there were tanks on the streets. Right, the problem surrounding Vietnam was families fighting families. It wasn't people in the North fighting people in the South or somebody on the West Coast beefing with the East Coast. It was between generations and families. So we have seen this kind of level of difficulty. Cities were burning. Right. Yes. Nobody. We had not seen an insurrection happen at the Capitol. But we have dealt with this before. And why does this actually matter? To me, it matters is in whether you wherever you are on the political continuum, it matters because America, we should want to be able to keep our role in the world. And that is no longer guaranteed. And it's no longer guaranteed because of the Chinese government. The Chinese government is trying to surpass the United States of America as a global superpower. That's not my opinion. That is what the Chinese government has said about themselves in English, in their own documents, and they're gonna do that in a number of about 12 to 14 different technologies. Why should Mexico and Canada care? Because it would be better to have a neighbor who has 24% of global GDP than 3%. Of global GDP. That's going to impact this broader region. So our way of life and the quality of life that Americans have enjoyed for the last couple of decades is at stake. Period, full stop. And so how do we get back to that? It goes back to solving problems. This isn't rocket science. I was able to demonstrate that when I was in Congress. I have other examples of elected officials that have been able to do it. And it starts with some very basic things that we learned in kindergarten. Don't be a jerk. Don't be a racist. Don't be a homophobe, right? Don't be against religions, right? Don't do those things. Let's start with that. And oftentimes the Republican Party is viewed as only the national leaders that are part of the Republican Party. And yes, that is one view, and I accept that view. But there's also the people that vote for Republicans, those people that voted for me and put me into office. There's a lot more of those people out there than there are the nuts that we pay attention to on social media and cable news.
I second that, and I think I was a Republican at least for a while, while you were in Congress.
Sure.
So definitely that's.
And that we can make you a Republican again, don't worry.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to that, and I'll close with that at the end, by all means. Let me go back to both of you with a question, piggybacking on your comment on China. Graham Allison, who many of us know and respect, suggests that because of China's leadership in the 21st century foundational technologies, that means AI and 5G and semiconductors and quantum computing and so forth, the U.S. must, and I underline must, try to coexist and avoid a Cold War. Do you agree? Do you both agree? And do you see a way to achieve it? And are we otherwise in a collision course of sorts?
We're already in a Cold War. And if we don't think that's the case, then we're not paying attention to what's actually happened, what's actually happening. And again, this goes back to what the Chinese government is saying about themselves. And we have to start there. And guess what?
Well, give me a minute.
Sure.
Perdón, de nuevo les pedimos un poco de silencio. Vamos a tener tiempo más adelante de platicar, pero creo que estamos platicando aquí de aspectos fundamentales de la situación en el mundo que atañen totalmente el futuro y la realidad de México. Entonces, por favor, un poquito de silencio. Muchas gracias. Sorry. Go ahead.
So, why is this Cold War different than the last Cold War? Because China is 4 times larger than us. That means we have to be 4 times more effective than them. We're never going to be able to outgrow them, so the United States needs partners. And the best partners to have is Mexico and Canada. We should be talking about North American competitiveness and how North America deals with the threat of China. And by the way, the U.S., Mexico, and Canada, we're married. And we can't get divorced. Right? And our relationships, our connections are so interconnected at so many different levels. We are lucky to have one another, and we have to go from that 40% and get that up to the 60% of us trading amongst ourselves. And in order to do that, we're gonna have to be leveraging these technologies. My buddies at Constellation Brands in Piedras Negras, they shouldn't have to be waiting for some person to come in and inspect the box to make sure all the bottles are okay. And by the way, sidebar, if you haven't had unpasteurized beer, it's amazing. Go. I'm hoping somebody from Constellation Brands here, y'all need to be running tours down there. It's pretty amazing. But we should be moving those boxes through as quickly as possible, automated, so that we can move at the speed of commerce. We have to embrace technology in order to do that. And what we're seeing, the best case scenario, I advise technology companies now. I'm on boards of AI companies, artificial intelligence companies, quantum computing companies, and at best, we're tied with the Chinese government. And guess what? We want our value system to drive these technologies, not folks that don't care about civil liberties, not folks that put ethnic minorities in concentration camps. This is not the way, that is not the kinds of guiding lights that we want in these technologies. And we are poised, if we work together, the three countries work together, in order to win this Cold War.
Shannon, your take?
So I think there are a lot of similarities. So this Cold War is going to be different and is different than the last Cold War, right? This is not about nuclear weapons as much, which is really the highlight of the U.S., Russia or USSR standoff. And many things, we're talking about a 21st century conflict or competition, which is different, and for a few different reasons. So yes, there could be, as the military would say, kinetic activity in, around Taiwan or other places, but that's not the main focus here, right? The main focus is technology. And one of the big differences from the previous Cold War is that the global economy has significantly changed. And so for advanced industrial economies, but also for the Chinese economy, increasingly services is the big part of things, not making of things. So before it was how many tanks could you make? And so, the USSR was trying to churn out all kinds of production of things. That's not where the value added lies anymore. Right now it is services. And then the other huge shift we've seen really in the last 25 years, really the 21st century, is you know, what economists like to call intangibles. And basically, intangibles are patents and royalties and brand names and other things that that have an incredible value. And that's gone from a pretty small part of economies to, in some places, 25-30% of the value of companies. And there, that is a different war, so to speak, right? That is a different standoff, and who is going to have that? So one is, who's going to have the technologies of the futures? Who's going to have the green technology? Who's going to control green hydrogen? Who's going to have the technologies for AI? Who's going to have the technologies for social media platforms? Where are those things going to happen? And so, given that this is the standoff, which I think is a very different one than we had back in the 60s and 70s, where you had two economies that were very walled off from each other, this is really a different kind of economic race, the battlefields are really different. And there are odd ones that we don't always keep an eye on. So for instance, I think today or tomorrow, there is a vote for the international standard setting body for the telecom space. And the vote is between an American who has deep ties in technology and telecoms and a Russian. And who wins this vote that's going to happen in a fairly opaque voting process will really determine the future of the open internet and the protocols that will be used for all kinds of technologies that will affect the companies and the people here in this room. And so that is the new battlefield that I think we need to be thinking about as individual companies, as citizens, as countries, but then also as a group of countries that wants the kinds of things Will was talking about, right? Free and open transparency, democracy, values. That's where this war, I think, is a bit different, but just as important.
Just to add on that, we space has been on all of our minds. You know, recently NASA had a satellite go into a asteroid to see if they can move it, but the Chinese recently put a satellite into space with a claw on it. There's only one reason you need a claw on a satellite. Is this going to do something to other satellites? This is where the battlefield is different. The battlefield, we know of domains like air, land, and sea, but space is a domain, and cyberspace is a domain as well. And whoever is able to control and develop the tactics, techniques, and procedures to excel in those areas are going to be able to be successful, and we're poised to do that. But in order to be leaders in these things, we have to have an educated workforce that can work on these things. And that means we got to streamline legal immigration in the United States. If the Chinese government is going to steal our technology, let's steal their engineers. Let's make sure if you're going to a U.S. university, when you graduate, you're going to get a visa to be able to continue to work there. If you're a Mexican student working in, at Texas A&M getting a degree in computer science, you're going to be able to get that internship opportunity one summer. We have to improve that so that we continue to benefit from the brain gain of every other country for the next couple of decades so that we can win in these new domains.
Following up on this, the realignment of supply chains is a real thing. It's happening. How much is Mexico part of the equation? I mean, you have the foundation spearheading thinking about this, and I think in a very positive way. But then you have UPS and others saying, well, it isn't really happening. What needs to happen? What are the preconditions for this to be real in the case of Mexico?
So it is happening, but not nearly as much as it should be happening. When I talk to different companies, almost everybody in their boards are discussing if they want to leave China, if they want to be a little bit less exposed to China, as they think about new capacity, do they want to put it somewhere else in the world rather than Asia or Europe or other places? So they're thinking about these issues and they're looking for places, right? This is really, I said it before, but it's a once in a generation opportunity where you see a fluidity that we have not seen since the early 90s. But this door will close. They will decide over the next few years, okay, this is where I'm going to put things, this is how it's going to work. They're going to find their new network of trusted suppliers, and then it's going to be very sticky until you see another great disruption that's happening around the world. So how does Mexico take advantage of this? Yes, some comes to Mexico because it has USMCA, because some people already have operations here, so they're just expanding capacity, because they see the access to the U.S. market, both in terms of you know, no tariffs, but time and you know, the ease of getting back and forth. But it's not as easy as it should be. So there are things that need to be done. One is, you know, we've talked already here today about logistics, but logistics between the three countries aren't what they could be. North America has a pretty good base of logistics. They have pretty good ports. They have, you know, lots of rivers. They have other things. But they haven't built out, none of the countries have really built out the logistical framework to make this, to make goods and services and people and ideas move much faster. And some of that's physical. It's roads and ports and rails. And some of it is digital. Some of it is making sure that customs is a lot easier than it should, than it is or has been in the past. Making sure that this kind of stuff, information and data moves much more easily than it has in the past. So that's one side. You know, the other side that I've heard every single panel and you just brought up is the talent side, right? You're asking companies to come. They're looking for places around the world to go. And everyone is talking about, you know, will I be able to find the workers I need? And I was in May, I was in Panama with the Bloomberg New Economy Forum and was talking to a bunch of people there. And they're like, yes, we could come to this, to here, but we cannot find the people trained to do the kinds of things we need them to do. And it's not just, you know, they're not astrophysicists that they're looking for. It's all kinds of layers. And so how do governments, and not just the federal government, but state governments, local governments, how do you create the schools, vocational schools, community colleges, other, you know, variations to create that workforce that allows people to come in quickly and train people up and actually have the workforce they need? So I think those are two areas where North America could and should be working together that would provide a boost that then makes it profitable to move.
And, you know, the sense of urgency should be there, not simply because of the fact that the doors are going to close regarding the process, but also because of demographics. Mexico is aging quite rapidly. So the demographic bonus is going to go away. And
All y'all have a role in this, if I can be frank. And part of this is, and y'all can do it through the U.S.-Mexico Foundation. You have to be, we have to get more people down here to Mexico and understand what Mexico really is. There are too many, especially with elected officials. You have a lot of elected officials that have this like 1980s or 1990s view of Mexico, and it's just wrong. When I was in Congress, I would always have to tell my colleagues, there are more Michelin star restaurants in Mexico City than they are in New York City. When you come here and you just look at the restaurants and people are working hard, everybody's dressed well, right? There's a lot of activity that's going here. And one way to improve that, because of that industrial policy that you were talking about, elected officials are going to have a role. And having institutions and foundations like the U.S.-Mexico Foundation, bringing these elected officials down here to see it, it changes their minds, it changes their opinions, and y'all making sure that they have the resources to do that is super important. Mexico should be the most visited country by members of Congress. It's not. It's not by a mile. Israel is the number one place that is that where people go to visit. And part of it is because there's great groups like AIPAC. And to all my Jewish brothers and sisters here, Happy New Year. But I want to see an organization that rivals that in bringing these people down here to understand this. And then that's how you're going to start changing this and asking those questions. Why aren't we ally shoring to Mexico? Why aren't we doing more? Why is there a crummy road from Eagle Pass to Piedras Negras? Piedras has this beautiful highway, and then when it comes to the U.S. side, it's this potholed road. And those, this is a role everybody in this room can play in order to ensure that this rebalancing actually happens.
We need to hire Dina Siegel, and she's right, sitting over there. Hi, Dina. Dina, we're talking about you. We need more of you working on the U.S.-Mexico connection, as Will was saying. I'm glad you mentioned the fact that we're doing so poorly in terms of student exchange. I mean, there's more Vietnamese students in the U.S. than Mexican. There's more students from the U.S. studying in Costa Rica than in Mexico. This just shouldn't happen. Your thoughts?
You know, so one is students, right? You need exposure to both places, and for historical reasons, and some of them are good and some of them are bad. You know, Mexicans and Mexican families have more exposure to the U.S., I think, than U.S. have to Mexico, right? Lots of people have family members or friends or neighbors who have spent some time in the U.S., lived there, studied there, what have you. We have much less exposure down here, right? U.S. students, when they think to go abroad, they don't rarely go here. Will's a good exception here in journalism, but others, but there are few that do that. So one is student exchanges. So I would say that's a big part. I would expand that aperture on the exchanges beyond just the, you know, the 2-year or 4-year college experience, right? I would think about it's if the goal here is to build out regional production platforms, which is what I think the goal should be, because that's what other places are doing around the world, and that's how they're making things that are better, faster, cheaper to sell to consumers all over the world. If that's the goal, then you need workers and companies on each element of that supply chain to have skills that fit the needs. And those supply chains are going to cross borders, so the workers need to be able to do some in some ways. It doesn't necessarily mean that people always have to move, but the skills have to be commensurate for what's needed in a particular part of that. So how do you do that, right? It is, yes, it's educational programs, it's vocational training. It is, you know, dare I say, validating credentials from one side of the border to the other. If somebody's a plumber in Mexico, should they be able to be a plumber in the United States? I mean, we have this challenge in the United States where many skill sets, you can't, if you have a certification in Texas, you actually can't fix a drain in Louisiana, right? That's a challenge we have that I think we need to work on in the United States in terms of labor mobility. But as we do that, we should be thinking about that for North America. And so how do you get the skill set up that people can seamlessly work across these different factories that are going to be, if it works out for us and if we're going to do this right, they're going to be seamless across borders too.
By the way, at Monterey Tech, we're very proud to have Shannon as part of our board of the School of Government, and she makes a huge difference, believe me. Will, you wanted to add something?
Unfortunately, immigration in the United States is an issue that Republicans and Democrats would rather use as a political bludgeon against each other rather than solving. The solution to this on the mechanics of the F-1 visa issuing, the J-1s, all that kind of stuff, can be sorted out. There's legislation that's been written that where we can do this. It requires a political will, which also means that those that care about this needs to be advocating with their elected officials to make sure that these are the kinds of policies that they're actually trying to get done in Washington and even in some of our state capitals.
You were a co-sponsor of one bill in Congress that I think would have made tremendous difference. Can you tell us about it? And in fact, you mentioned in an interview with Andrew Yang that it was one of your major frustrations that it didn't pass.
Well, thanks for getting my blood pressure up on the USA Act. A good friend of mine, Pete Aguilar, a Democrat from California, and I, at Stoney's prompting, worked on what would a solution to immigration be. How do you fix the problem for DACA kids, Dreamers, young kids who have only known the United States of America as their own? They're already contributing to our society, contributing to our economy. These kids are Americans. They should be able to stay in the United States. How do we streamline legal immigration? In this day and age, we should be able to determine if you need more high-tech workers in Texas and seasonal workers in Florida, we should be able to have that demand based, you know, month to month and make sure we're issuing those kinds of visas. So we address that. We dealt with this this asylum issue of immigration judges so that people are not waiting years to go through an immigration court. Oh, and by the way, we were focused on addressing root causes in places like the Northern Triangle to address the economic push factors that was contributing to illegal immigration in the United States. And we had developed this. We had north of 240 votes in the House. You only need 218. Oh. And look, the Republican speaker at the time prevented this bill from coming to the floor. But guess what? The next year, the Democratic speaker prevented that from coming to the floor as well too. And that part was frustrating. But when you look at actual voters, all of those elements I just outlined, super supportive by primary voters, Republican and Democrat, but it requires the political will of folks to do this. And now is the time we should have done that when you have industries that need workers, but going into a difficult financial situation over the next year or two, it's gonna be even harder to pass these kinds of things. The time to do it was when times are good, and we missed out on that.
Gosh, sorry to hear that in more detail. I mean, I think we missed on a huge opportunity. We need to wrap up, unfortunately, but let me ask you both to discuss with us, within the realms of the feasible, of what's really feasible, what, if anything, I hope there is something, keeps you hopeful today with regards to the future of North America as a partnership, as a region?
To me, it is that there are industries and sectors where this has worked. And you see globally competitive industries and sectors precisely because of North American integration. You know, one of them is the auto industry, and we'll see a transformation of the auto industry in the next 10 to 15 years, and that can be a North American project. It doesn't have to be a single country. We've seen it in aerospace, we've seen it in agriculture, we've seen it in medical devices, we've seen it in all these areas. So we have actually a proven track record that this makes companies more profitable, it creates jobs, it creates supply chains that stay on this continent and don't go to other places. So we have that. The other thing that makes me hopeful is we have a change in some parts of the United States, but I think a change that's somewhat bipartisan, partly because of China, where we see a different logic than we did maybe 20 years ago in terms of the usefulness or the necessity of engaging with other countries and engaging with quote-unquote allies. So, you know, we have a critical supply chain report. We have four areas that the U.S. has designated for national security reasons. We need to have better control over, you know, critical minerals, large capacity batteries, electric vehicle batteries, semiconductors, and pharmaceuticals and medical devices. How are we going to do this? We're going to find out very quickly. We can't do it in one place, and there's vulnerabilities to doing it in one place in the United States, and so we're going to look for allies. So that, too, gives me hope that as we start looking around, who are our closest commercial allies? Well, they're going to look north and south. So I think there is this big opportunity. So I'm not pessimistic. I think I'm hopeful there, but what I do worry is that both sets of governments and then those that follow them won't grasp this in the moment. And the moment is really now, and it's not going to last forever.
I think there's more examples than not. I start with when Texas was having a grid problem, where do we get our energy from? Mexico. I think about when we were having a difficult issues on the border, the level of cooperation between the border services with the highest it had ever been in a really long time. I took some members of Congress across the border in Juarez, and we're at our old embassy that turned into an incubator, and we're walking along, and we asked this kid, what does he do? And he was some kid from the Chicago who was a former Marine that was starting a company in Juarez and using this incubator. The number of American investors that are excited about some great tech companies that are starting here in Mexico. So all of those examples are great. And then it's also it's wonderful coming in to an event like this and seeing old friends who have been fighting this issue and advocating for the importance of the bilateral relationship and the trilateral relationship for years, but meeting new people that are continuing to do that and seeing organizations like the U.S.-Mexico Foundation that is growing in stature and size and resources to influence this. And you have people outside of the formal chains of government that are impacting this relationship. So I think it's exciting. I truly believe our best days are ahead of us as long as we all make folks remember why this is important. We can't take this relationship for granted. And I always ask my friends from the diplomatic corps from other countries, would you rather have your neighbors or would you rather have the neighbors of the United States? Everybody always says, I'd rather have Mexico and Canada. And so this is a real opportunity. And like I said, I think our future is exciting.
Wonderful closing. Thank you so much. Shannon, always a pleasure. Please continue providing inspiration and substance to rekindle the North American dream. And I dare say, if I may, along the way, don't lose the prose. Don't lose the cadence. For example, I need to read this. It's going to take 10 seconds. You describe tech innovation in polymer chemistry in Akron this way. This is in page 155. Those of you who got the book can check it. Pipes latticed like snake skins to stave off corrosion, and bird-friendly building glass with spider-like strands woven into panes.
This is like Faulkner writing about quotas and tariffs. A beautiful book, congratulations. It's not only beautiful, but it's more importantly, just so much substance and so much inspiration again. Thank you so much. And Will, hope to see you in San Antonio too, my friend. Your book is amazing. It's so timely, it's inspirational. Will you run for president in 2024? It's not a question, it's a request.
Please.
Thank you both so much. Mil gracias a la US-Mexico Foundation y gracias a todos ustedes.